Hey, this is Mike with Drumline. I'm with Alex Dontry of Psycho Stick, which is an incredible band out of...
We are incredible. We started in Arizona, and then we moved to Chicago not too long ago, so we're kind of based out of there.
It's more you're centrally based out of the Midwest? Located.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So now we can get anywhere in the country without having to travel 3,000 miles to start a tour in Massachusetts or whatever it would be.
Okay.
So, makes it a little easier.
Okay. I found out about you from Little Rock Star, who I met with the Mushroom Head and Unsaid Fate and some other things. So I saw you guys on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
And I heard the name, but I hadn't heard the music before. So when I was checking it out, I was like, this is a really cool sense of humor.
We try. And
that was that the origin of a couple of guys in the band?
Yeah, it was myself, Rob, our singer, who's asleep behind the camera, and Josh. The three of us started the band with some other bass players in the past, and then we just got our latest bass player, hopefully the last and final one, got him 4 years ago. So we got our solid lineup. So it's been going for, 14 years now?
Wow.
So been at it for a while.
Okay, and then, but the thing about it is it's no joke as far as, like, the music. Because it's very intense and very progressive and a lot of changes to the material. And that really grabbed me, like, right away. I thought, I'm like, damn.
Good.
Yeah.
We try not to make it just boring, like a joke band or something. You know, we make jokes, but it's like a comedian. They take their works very seriously. You know, they want to perform it well. It's not just, I'm going to get up and make dumb fart jokes and that's it. They don't put any thought into it. It's not like that at all.
Right. Know? Well, the timing in comedy is important. The timing on your guys' music is you guys turn
it's
on
equally
a, turn,
important.
You turn on a dime.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I love that about it. It's really
thank you.
You can play, and you play a lot of styles.
Mm-hmm.
Seems like you're influenced by many things. I could probably guess some of them, but I don't want to, let's hear from you. Some of the styles that you enjoy. And,
well, definitely Primus. They were...
Yeah, I was going to say.
Yeah.
I didn't want to say it, but yeah.
You can say Primus. No.
Yeah, it's right there.
The first two concerts I ever went to were in 99 and 2000. Primus was at both of them, and they changed my life, honestly. So that was a big part of it. Machine Head, Dave McLean from Machine Head was a huge influence. Thomas from Meshuggah. All the drummers from Dillinger Escape Plan, like there's a lot of them, but those are probably the biggest ones I can think of right now. And Travis Barker.
Okay.
So pretty wide variety, I guess.
How did you get started? I mean, playing drums or?
When I was 11, I played saxophone.
Okay.
And I sucked at it. It was really bad. And then when I was 12, I decided that the saxophone is gross because you're playing and there's like spit coming out of the bottom, and I decided I wanted nothing to do with it. So a year after doing that, I switched to drums because you didn't have to blow into anything and drop spit on the floor. That was my initial reason.
So drums are cleaner.
Yeah, they're cleaner.
Less
unless you like smash your finger and bleed everywhere. That's not very clean.
Unless you're Seven Antonopoulos, because he spits everywhere. So
I need to look that up then.
Yeah,
I'm sure it's very exciting.
It's not so fun to shoot him. You know what I'm talking about? When he's playing live.
Yeah. But,
something interesting about you, you're also in school.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you manage that with being on the road?
I started school September of 2011, and it's March of 2014 now. So I'm actually about a month and a half from getting my associate's. It's all online, but it's a community college, so they do both. They do regular traditional courses as well as online. So I'm fortunate enough to where I can actually do that. We have a Verizon MiFi card, so I can log in on the internet in the middle of nowhere and just work on that, or 8-hour drives or whatever it is, and it's crazy. And just scheduling tests is really the biggest obstacle, because I can read and study. That's not really a problem. It's just I've done tests in like 8 different states. It's pretty that's the most difficult part.
Is it a little bit easier being on the road? You've got something to do in some of your downtime, or
it's not easier.
It
occupies my time.
Okay.
It's definitely challenging, but I enjoy challenge, otherwise I wouldn't be doing both, and I'm not one to compromise, because I want to do school, and I don't want to stop doing music, obviously, so I said, screw it, I'll do both, and now I'm always busy, and that's fine, because I feel very, accomplished at this point. Like, I'm doing a lot, and I feel like I'm accomplishing a lot with it.
So. Well, is it a financial mm-hmm. planning, or finance?
At my community college, it's a finance degree, and then...
Okay.
When I switched to Franklin University, it's a similar type of setup. It's an actual 4-year university, but they have financial planning, which I want to try to learn more about.
Well, do you use some of that skill on the road with your band at all? You guys bring in
beginning to. Not necessarily, not just yet, but I'm starting to take all the stuff I'm learning from school and bring it into the business of, our music.
Of what you're
business.
Doing.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there was a little bit of crossover.
Yeah, it's starting to become
more
and more.
Does it help you... I mean, does it help you understand what's going on as far as, you know, keep track of what's your money and...
Yeah, absolutely. Part of the reason why I started in the first place, I just wanted to do a couple courses to not be so bad at it, because I was always so bad with money. It's always month to month, you know, like so many people are. And I had no intention to take it as far as I have, but it just, that's how it worked out. I was doing well and decided, why not? I'll just keep doing it.
You have a meticulous nature, I think, maybe from playing the drums and maybe some of that paying attention to set those sort of things.
It could be.
A little bit of crossover. I don't know. It could be compatible.
It seems very plausible.
I'm always looking for stuff that people are into a little bit, you know, mm-hmm. besides the drums or, you know, like Jason Sutter's paints Warhol stuff.
And, oh, really?
Yeah, he painted with one of the guys that painted with Warhol in the factory. And
that's awesome.
Actually was doing a picture of Marilyn Monroe when he got called from Marilyn Manson. And But just to find out his whole art background, his mm-hmm. dad is a sculptor and things like that. So I'm always kind of looking, and you guys are, you know, not just playing music and not just playing drums. You're playing art. You're mm-hmm. putting on a performance. You guys are doing your videos. Mm-hmm. You've got, you know, a guy wearing a moose hat. You got a guy wearing, I don't know, are those party the party hat?
Yeah, I got
So, did I give away anything? Everybody knows that if they've seen the videos, I guess.
Yeah, I used to wear a cow suit years ago.
Oh, okay.
And I thought it was funny, and it was funny for a while, but at one show in Phoenix, I felt like I almost passed out because it was really hot.
Okay.
An extra layer of clothing, I'm like, all right, no more of this.
Right.
So now I just, you know, I've done some other things since then, but... I was like, all right, it's funny until I die on stage. And
some people are lactose intolerant, so.
Yeah. And I'm allergic to shellfish. I don't know how that's related.
Don't wear crabs.
Yeah, don't wear crabs.
Do you guys pick up a show here and there along the way, or everything's like all planned out?
We try to make it all planned out.
Does it ever happen to where something just pops up? And
occasionally.
You have a day or two off, but not too often.
Yeah, every once in a great while we'll do that. I think it was a drive somewhere in the West Coast. We were driving through Salt Lake City. Maybe it's Colorado. I forget. It was somewhere in the mountain region, and we got a call from a promoter asking where we were. I'm like, it's our day off. What are you talking about? Who are you? Like, oh, we have this show, and it was directly on the way from wherever we were going.
And so we just pull over and play. Why
not? Yeah, it's exactly what we did. We pulled in, played a show, took off.
So you can sleep on the truck or the. You have bunks or not so much?
We don't have bunks, but we have seats, and we call it van sleep. It doesn't really count as actual sleep.
So you did that last night?
Yeah. We drove straight through from Alabama to St. Louis last night. So
600 miles or more.
What can you do?
Motel 6. But anyway.
Yeah.
Your singer's asleep over there. I hope I'm not bugging him.
I hope you are bugging
him. You're at the Fabulous Pops in Sauget.
Yeah.
Sauget is actually... considered, I mean, it's just on the crest of the river from St. Louis.
Mm-hmm. You guys love this place. One of the best in the country.
Oh, the venue?
Mm-hmm.
You guys have a chance to do anything? Are you going out tonight? Is it show tomorrow?
We have our final show of the tour tomorrow in Pontiac, Illinois, which is about, I think it's an hour south of Chicago, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, okay, so not too bad.
47 minutes south of Chicago, evidently.
So you guys take off after the show tonight, or just maybe just get
to be
sleep?
Determined. Not sure.
See how you feel? Two nights in a row.
Yeah, it's all up in the air. They have showers here, so who cares, really?
That helps.
Yeah, you can sleep anytime, but a shower, that's what you want.
Primo on the road.
Yeah. I'm endorsed by four companies, and they're all really, really fantastic groups of people. I have Orange County. I think they're owned by Guitar Center, or I don't know who the hierarchy goes at this point.
Yeah, was it Travis Barker or something?
Mm-hmm.
Or one of the owners or starters of that?
I believe it was him and Adrian Young, if I'm not mistaken.
I think so. I really like the look of those drums. I've never really played them. But.
I love them. It's the snare, really, that got me interested in the first place, because they have the huge vents in the side. Just makes it really loud and just aggressive. It does one thing really well, but that one thing happens to be the thing I like.
When I see the kits, too, they look affordable, very affordable as well, but just really high quality.
Mm-hmm. I like them a lot. They've been great to me. I have my second one. I had a Red Sparkle Avalon was a model, and now I have a Green Sparkle.
The green one I saw out there.
The Newport, yeah.
Oh, that's nice. And you play kind of a jazz kit, don't you? I mean, jazzy setup? Or
yeah, it's a four-piece. I got a 12-inch tom, 16-inch tom, 22 kick, and 14 snare, so pretty simple.
I guess in the 90s, everybody started going to that, you know, the jazz kit, you know, mm-hmm. Pearl Jam, and I think the players are so good now that they can really be creative on that, and you don't need as many drums, and not to say don't buy a lot of drums, but it just seems like they're really creative players playing a small kit. They play on a four-piece kit or a five-piece kit.
Yeah.
One rack tom. And
I use this joke all the time, so forgive me, but I always tell the sound guys when they see my kit after doing like a 10-piece drum set from the other bands or whatever, they see my little kit and they're like, that's nice, you know, they actually appreciate it. And I tell them, well, I'm not an octopus, I only have two arms, I only need two toms.
Actually, it's good enough for Buddy Rich. I still got to
practice. Yeah, right?
But Elliot probably likes it.
Yeah, I'm sure he does.
Yes, it's fantastic.
Yeah, instead of loading massive water drums and double kicks and racks and all that craziness.
Well, so you guys are in Chicago. I mean, that's your base.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So when you're not... How much of the year do you actually play out? It's your season again to go out kind of thing? We're out for 3 or 4 months, or how does that work?
We avoid the winters because we've slid off the road twice in the past, both on the I-80, both in February, and it was terrifying. So that's not fun. So we just try to avoid the winter months for touring, but we average maybe around 100, 120 shows a year, or something like that.
And so you're out basically every year?
Yeah. We haven't not been out at all for a year since we started in 06. Not the band, but the touring cycles. We started touring in 06.
Okay. What's like maybe your coolest gig in your mind? You know, I'm sure there's many, but there's got to be a couple that...
As far as shows we played?
Yeah, or stuff that you played that you really...
We love the Machine Shop in Flint, Michigan. They're awesome. We love Pops. I mean, we're here tonight. It's just such a great place. I mean, there's a lot of them that... I mean, I could go on and on, really. But there's a ton of great places. I mean, I've had fun and... You know, a bunch of states. We went to Canada once, and that was one of the best shows we ever played in Calgary.
And you just had no idea when you walked in there.
Yeah. Exactly what they to flew expect. Us out. They were so great. They were awesome people. We got to play with Pig Destroyer, which was incredible. If you haven't heard that guy play drums.
I haven't.
Unreal. One of the fastest, I don't even know how he does it, but he's incredible.
That's the cool thing about interviewing bands. You see a band and they know someone else, and I've been on quite a journey because, like, from jazz to rock, I mean, so many different guys in so many different situations. So my mind is constantly being expanded.
That's good, though. That's smart.
Yeah. And so I feel pretty lucky.
Yeah.
You know, that I've been able to be exposed for so many things.
You and me both.
Yeah.
That's actually how we found our bass player was the drummer from Dillinger Escape Plan. Because what happened was, we lost our old bass player at the end of 09, so the beginning of 2010, I had been talking to Billy from Dillinger just online, because I'm a huge fan of the band, and just saying hi, talking drum stuff here and there, like, not really friends, just, hey, I'm a fan, can I talk a little bit, you know, that kind of thing. And I asked him one day when we were looking for a bass player, hey, if you know anybody, you know, send me a name. He's like, he sends me his phone number, call me right now. I'm like, okay. Super intimidated, but he had Bat, our guy we've had ever since, for 4 years now. He hooked us up with him because they've been best friends forever, so they grew up together.
So were you in the band for the 14 years or so?
Since we started,
Since you started. I think we covered pretty much.
If there's anything else you want to know, I'm happy to blab some more.
Your favorite color?
Probably blue. No, I can't say that because I live in Ohio now. It can't be blue because they hate it there.
I asked Will Calhoun that. He said yellow.
They do. They all hate blue and yellow because... Isn't it yellow? The Michigan colors or something? I don't know.
Black
I get
and yellow
lost.
Is Pittsburgh.
Black and yellow? Okay. I don't know. I like blue. Whatever.
Yeah, we ran out of stuff to talk about. So, I had to go to my favorite color.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
I had a great time. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.